experience. I was 20 when my son was born and 22 when my daughter was born. And so I did a lot of, had to do a lot of growing up with them. And I tried a lot of different things to try to be a good parent. And one of the things I observed is that when the pressure's on, the tendency is to fall back into what our parents did. And sometimes, fortunately, we're lucky in that regard, and other times it's not so lucky because there was probably a mixture in everyone's upbringing that was some good and some bad. And I haven't met anybody yet who was raised by fully enlightened beings. So it kind of comes with the territory. And later on, I was involved in helping with parenting classes. And what I noticed was that most of the time, the people who came to the classes were in search of a way to get their children to do what they wanted them to do. And it's pretty understandable because we're constantly, as parents, trying to help them stay safe and become good people and have good values and get along with people in the world and deal with the many problems that they encounter. And from my perspective and my degree, I think parenting is one of the hardest jobs on the planet. Part because it's so relentless. And when my children were 7 and 10 years old, I got divorced, so then a lot of the time it was single parenting as well, and that is another whole layer of challenge because you don't have the tag team effect when you're completely with your back against the wall, not knowing what to do with these people. And being up against working with your own feelings in a way that doesn't lead to harm for them. So mindfulness and other teachings of the Buddha are incredibly helpful with these challenges. And as you can see, I'm a Theravada nun, and so this these thoughts that I want to share with you are really grounded in early Buddhism. And what the Buddha taught, and particularly what he taught about mindfulness. So, the Buddha's teaching of mindfulness was about being able to be present with experience, aware of it, and not only aware of our experience, which immediately puts it into this a dynamic of being an object to us, but also being aware of it and then bringing in clear comprehension and wisdom and also kindness around how to relate to this experience. So what that means is that when we're trying to deal with a situation with our child, when they're upset, and maybe we're upset, is that by bringing mindfulness to this experience, we're, with some practice, able to observe what we're feeling without being caught up in it, and be able to listen to them and try to understand what they're experiencing at the same time. And this is really challenging, but it can be done, and it takes practice. And so this is why mindfulness is important to practice when we're not having challenges, just, you know, whether it's part of our formal meditation practice or it's something that we're doing throughout the day, that's the best, so that we can learn to be present with things that aren't so charged, so that we have that built-in pattern, so that when things get challenging, we drop into this awareness. really learned, instead of just how to get their kids to do what they wanted them to do, was how to listen to their kids. And the encouragement was to really listen. And now that, you know, I put this in a context of the Buddhist teachings, I really see it as seeing the situation as it is and seeing this other person here as they are. And of course, this can be applied to any aspect of our life and any relationship. But to see our child in the state that they are and try to understand it and try to understand and help them to express what it is that's going on for them. And then also finding the ways that we can express what's going on for us. How we can explain to them how important it is and how it affects us when they behave in certain ways, for example. Now you might think that, and it's in some ways true, that this changes as they develop. Certainly challenges change as they develop. But the fundamental ability to be able to be present with mindfulness when we're interacting with them stays the same. And being able to see like what state they're in, what state we're in, how that's affecting things, what can be done to support them, and what we need to support us, all in the same process, is really possible and something that we can practice. And then what I tend to do to practice for this is to use awareness of my breathing, even as I'm listening. And my son in particular has this incredible capability to talk forever and without, you know, much opportunity to get a word in. And so I found that, you know, really being present with my breath and listening to him helped me to see where all that was coming from and to bring a sense of calm to the situation. And it was helping me not feel like I had to react to what he was saying so much. And I could really like let this process unfold and come away from it with a peacefulness in myself. And it's like, and then being there, able to really come to a place where I knew what I wanted to say to try to support what was happening in a good way, move it in a good way, influence it in a good way. One of the things that is part of the early Buddhist teachings is a belief that we live many lifetimes. And I am firmly convinced of this. And now as I see my grandchildren, who are 8 and 11 years old, observing them from their birth with this idea in mind, it seems so clear that they've come in with a whole bunch of conditioning already, likes and dislikes, tendencies. And that's really helpful when you're parenting, to recognize that this is not a blank slate that you're working with, but someone who's come in with a lot that's already going on. And to be able to use mindfulness to be able to be present with what that is and begin to see it and understand it so that we can help guide them. And also the awareness that there's, because of this and all kinds of other factors, there's a lot that we're not responsible for with kids, with our, whether they're little or now might are in their 40s. It's like there's a lot of responsibility with being a parent, but there's so much that's outside our control. And we've seen parents be very karma, the background, what they've come in with. And so we can do our best to try to support that in a positive direction. And then letting go and having equanimity about it. It's hard, but it's possible. And it comes with practice. So just knowing that every being, every living being comes in with a history and leaves, they have their own path. And we have the opportunity to support that as they're in our life. But that's about all. It's not in our control. I really figured that out when my son was about 2 years old. This is a process that is not in my control. And the sooner I accepted that, the better, more happiness I had. So my objective became to just, as best I could, keep him from doing long-term damage to himself or others. And that worked pretty well, actually. He later became a Buddhist monk. That's how I got like this. It's pretty good influence. So one of the things that will happen as we're parents is that we'll make a lot of mistakes, or they may look like mistakes. And the Buddha's teaching about mistakes, or doing things that are unskillful, you might say, or doing things that create unpleasant results, is that we learn from that and let it go. You know, really acknowledge, forgive, and learn. And this is very important as a mantra for parents, because we can carry a lot of baggage, and we can carry a lot towards our own parents, and it's really productive, helpful, freeing to be able to see them as they actually are in the stages of their own development. So this, seeing things as they are, using mindfulness to observe at various times, at stages, at intervals, whenever we think of it, whenever we have the chance, see that person as they are now, whether it's our child, our parent, or anyone else. And say our tendency is to come to each interaction with a whole storehouse of experience with this person. And it leads, it, of course, we have to acknowledge what we know about them, but also it leads to our not really being able to see them afresh. Maybe you've experienced this, I've seen it over and over again, that parents, even though their children are grown, can't see them as adults. And if we take up the practice of seeing who they are now as these changing, as they are a changing process, then we can much better respond to what they need and what we need in our interactions. Especially, I found when they were teenagers, I thought, I just never really know who I'm going to meet in the hallway when I get up in the morning, because sometimes they're 20 and sometimes they're 2. And it's just like this change all the time. And sometimes they really are resentful of my help because they're so grown up. And sometimes they really are crying out for it. And it's like, can I mindfully move with these changes, observing and being present with them, and at the same time being present with the changes internally in me, and how can I work with that? It's lovely if you can teach your kids how to be mindful, particularly mindful of feeling, and this is, I think, the diamond, the real treasure in mindfulness is to be able to be present with what we feel and not be awash in it and not be needing to suppress it or find some way not who we are, that it's constantly changing, and just be able to like work with it as an object. This is a very important way to deal with the kind of suffering. And if we can teach our children that, so that when they're experiencing anger, for example, instead of being upset with them for being angry or trying to, somehow force them to not be angry, the best remedy just allowing them to rev up that anger is to see if there's a way to teach them how to be present with their feelings. If they can employ mindfulness instead of acting out when they're feeling something, this is a big gain. And we do it a lot by our own example. You know, if we're angry with them and tell them we feel angry, but we're going to stay present with this feeling of anger and want them to wait a minute for us to calm down and then talk about what's happening, that's a huge positive example for them. And it's very sophisticated for us to be able to do.
For me, like, a big question that I always have is, like the kids will come into my class and they usually are in crisis. And so they're sort of, like, uncontrollable. Like, even if I ask them, like, why don't we take a second? Or even if I go, hey, let's sit down and ask yourself why you're feeling this way. But they can't get out of that loop. I don't know how to break it so that it's not forced or that it's not contrived, because if it's contrived, I can see them sort of like going, like, what's that? Or,
right.
I know what you're doing, and they don't want to, you know what I mean? Especially like teenagers, they'll be like, no, like, I know what you want me to do, I don't want to do that. Yeah.
It's a tough one, because it depends so much on the situation and the person and how they are right at the time. I think the very first thing, of course, is how calm you can be. I'm sure you know that already. And I think it's good if it's possible, as you're teaching poetry, about working in dropping some little pebbles around how valuable it is to be able to stay present with our feelings rather than acting out them. You know, maybe talking about things a little bit, maybe sharing stories where you see that happening. And delivering Dhamma down your throat, but, you know, to get them to look at the, you know, I'll just put it in the terms, I know you understand, the gratification, danger, and escape.
Mm.
You know, like, what do we get out of being hungry or upset? Or what do we, what is the danger in it? You know, trying to help them see the more long view. That's one of the things, you know, that is really valuable for kids. As adults, we have a longer view than they have. And to help them see the longer view, you know, what's it going to be like in 3 years or 5 years or 10 years? You still want to have these meltdowns, or maybe try something else. But I think for them and for any kid, no matter how old they are, really having the respect that they have this choice of how they want to handle it. You know, I can give you a different example. I can give you some different ideas. I can give you some boundaries that I need to hold because of whatever else is important for anybody's safety or whatever. And some consequences that we have to go with that if we go outside those boundaries. But really, in the end of the day, it's your choice. It's your choice what you say. It's your choice what you do. And it's your choice how you feel. And if they can grasp that they have choices and that they can actually do things in a way that's going to be better for them, they might just take it up. And it's also the case that they might not take it up now, but some seed might sprout later on. I had that crazy teacher. He was so out there. I remember him, though, and I think he might have been onto something.
Sits with me sometimes and he'll sit in my lap as I meditate, so he bows to the Buddhist statue in my home. So he has these things, but you know, he's 3 and a half, he's just mimicking at this point.
Yeah. But that's a good mimicking.
Yeah. So I guess just keep up with that. How does that kind of go?
Yeah, and with a 9-year-old you might try inside timer.
Nine months.
Oh,
sorry.
Okay. It's a little early for the segment. sorry, I didn't quite hear your exact sentence. So
okay.
Yeah, so it sounds, that's really good, and I think the working with meltdowns is really helpful. Like just using those principles of mindfulness and real, like, you know, that listening where you're listening, you're feeding back what you're experiencing and you're hearing, and, you know, those kinds of things, not in a forced way, not in a, you know, like, template way, but to just, like, use those ways of working with feeling. know, when we're that age, like 3 and a half, it's very hard to know how to deal with these feelings that rush through. Another practice that's kind of fun at that age is working with a bell and just, you know, if you have a bell like this, then, you know, just letting them hold the bell if they can. And then striking it and just like waiting until the sound is completely gone. You know, just something simple like that is a little fun meditation. You might think about, I don't, what's his person, his, they're two boys,
two boys.
What's his personality, right?
Well, he's a 3 and a half year old, so he's pretty, he's pretty willful. He wants to. Well, it's funny when you're talking about that, you didn't know, you know, if they want their help, or if they want their help, you know, it's like, sometimes they really want, other times they don't. So he's already experimenting with that.
Right.
He wants to be able to, you know, do things
himself.
He wants
to do it himself. When they get a little bit older, then sometimes using Insight Timer is nice. It's an application, I don't know if you know what it is, but there are a lot of guided meditations for kids, and sometimes they get into that and really enjoy it.
My son is older, you know, and it's, some challenges occur when, or for me, the big one is when you see them doing something that you flat out know is harmful, you know,
yeah.
For them.
Yeah.
And I actually, I'm kind of, yeah. It's funny what came to my mind though, that with an issue like that, and that I've got to treat it. I've got to treat it as I would a friend, and I don't want to be his friend. I mean, I know parents, you know, but I've got to be as careful about the way I engage with him about this topic as I would be if it was my friend, you know,
yes.
Who didn't meditate, didn't have, you know, didn't have the tool, you know, did not, you know, instead of trying to, yeah, but to be very respectful and kind and loving.
Yeah, this is
sometimes.
Another part of seeing him as an adult, you know, so that's
yeah.
Good stuff, seeing him the way he is. And then I think what you're saying about treating it as if, you know, this is another adult, and the difference between him and a friend is that you are the parent, and you do have more knowledge about him than anyone, and it's quite possible that you love him more than anyone else in the world does. And sometimes it's useful to remind them of that. And not that there's any strings attached to it, not that you have to be any certain way for me, but I care about how you are, and I'm here to listen to you. And it's your choice. I'm worried about these dangers, and that's what worries me. And so speaking from that place of how you feel, why you're worried, what you see as the result down the road, this is a very important thing to try to teach our kids, you know, to look at what would be the results of saying these things or doing these things. It's a really important thing to practice for ourselves. looking ahead. And then equanimity, because if you can let go of the consequence, whatever his decisions are, and see it as the process that he obviously is choosing or in, somehow in, and it's not in your control, and then to just recognize that somehow that's got to play out, it's going to have another side to it at some point. And, you know, you give whatever influence you can. It's very hard to watch our kids make decisions that you know are not helpful. But by the time they're, you know, they're mid-teens, there's not a lot you can do about it. It's really
something.
Oh, totally. Mm-hmm. They've been teaching me from day one. And I think that respect for them and their ability to know things and to do things and to have wisdom has been really helpful for them. You know, Buddhism, like this idea of being mindful and having clear comprehension and having that you see wisdom where it is and you see it where it's not and you call it like it is. And so it's like, you know, really, really being willing to learn from them. And also giving them opportunities to develop wisdom and to shine. I don't know if this is a useful example, but when I was single mom working in high tech, so lots of hours. It was come up on election time, and I didn't have time to do any research, and so I gave that responsibility to my daughter, who was in middle school. And she totally did it. She did the research. I voted the way she wanted me to vote. And, you know, like, you're getting to vote here, kid. You know what the story is. And we would read through some of the descriptions together. We would talk about the issues. But she really, like, rose to the occasion. And, so see what you can do to engage them in things where you do learn from them.
This is not a question about parenting, but interacting with parents being child level.
I did mention that this evening would be applicable if you were a parent or a child.
Now that me and my siblings are coming into adulthood, there is a growing awareness I'm noticing among my parents, especially my mother. In reflection of what she did right and what she did wrong, and I'm noticing there's a kind of she may be experiencing sort of guilt around what she did wrong, and there's a sort of desperation to make right, and wondering ways that to kind of let her know it's okay, and to express gratitude for what she did right.
Yes. I mean, any opportunity you have when you see her become anxious or, you know, reflecting on what didn't go so well, I think it's important to remind ourselves too when we are experiencing that, and our parents, there was a lot going on that we're not remembering. There are a lot of reasons why we do what we do and the choices we make at the time. The 20/20 hindsight thing is really a thing. You know, we think we could do it better if we knew what we knew and what we know now, but that's not the situation. And parenting is incredibly complex. There's no way we're going to get it right all the time. You have to make 1,000 decisions a week, you know? And so just, I like that your attitude is let her off the hook. And the other thing is, remind her that you're grown up now. And whatever happened, you have the choice whether to keep that rolling or change. And it's like for anybody, you know, like this kind of like, since we have in Western countries, it kind of like it's our parents' fault how we turned out. Once you're an adult, you have the choice to change that. I know that there can be serious trauma that takes a lot to work through, and that's true and it's hard, but it's still up to us to set the direction from here on and let go as much as possible of any resentment we might have. And let those people in our life forgive themselves and be forgiven by us. It just removes an incredible burden of suffering. Any complaints about that? Anything else? This is your chance.
It's kind of hard to talk about, yeah, I'm undoing all these things, but also, like, how do I let you know that, like, you know, that it's
okay.
Not your responsibility anymore,
yeah,
that it's
yeah.
Okay, right? Although, like, of course, like, as things come up, I will be like, yeah, I was upset about that, or yeah. You know what I mean? It's kind of hard to get them to
mm-hmm.
understand that it's not about them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Especially if we still feel upset about it. So first step is working through that. And again, it's the same process. It's like mindfulness of that feeling when you think about the thing that happened in the past and the feeling that it brings up, being mindful and present with it, noticing where it presents itself in the body, being able to watch that change, inquiring into it about what's behind it, you know, really working with it in a way that it gets resolved. And letting go is the practice. It's just like continual letting go. Whether you're in meditation and you're letting go of, you know, anxiety and thought, you're letting go of, you're always letting go of something. This is the way to peace and happiness. And so letting go of that resentment, a lot of times all we need to do is see that it's still there, and then that can be enough. Notice that this is suffering. Why am I holding on to this burning rock? and then when that feeling is resolved in us more, And we're also able to work with, you know, you're still in relationship with your parents, even when my mom was in the process of dying. She wasn't quite actively dying yet, but I was staying with her to take care of her because she couldn't really walk safely, and we knew there was only months left. Some things that she would say would still bring up such strong feeling in me. And, you know, a long time before that, I knew that I didn't want to be irritable with her, but it's hard not to. And so the practice is like, oh, I know when she says this, I'm going to have this feeling. And then I'm just going to be with that feeling, and I'm not going to react on it. And it's like, this is the practice. This is be with this feeling. Know that it's going to go away. There's nothing really wrong. There's nothing really, you know, there's no reason to really be upset because it's just this old stuff. And so it's you know, like, as much as possible being prepared for that. And then, as you're kind of indicating, being conscientious about how much you share with them about what you're doing and trying to share things you're changing in your life in a way that, you know, you also acknowledge that your ability to change these things also comes from conditioning that came being raised by them. And let them, like you said, be conscious and grateful for all the things that they did. They're changing physically and emotionally. I think the very best thing we can do is listen. Be willing to keep coming back to, you know, looking with what they're feeling and what they need and what's going on for them and what's going on for us. It takes a lot of patience and endurance, I think, generally. I mean, every relationship is different, so it depends. But all these qualities that we're touching on are valuable for the practice in any situation, any relationship, any workplace. So those classes that I was involved with years ago were from parents, but they had their version for teachers, so they have the version for managers, and they have, you know, it's the same kind of stuff. Coming to terms with our own emotions and our own experience in a way that we can, you know, have this solid ground of mindfulness, regardless of what's happening, we are sensible to discover. So as we develop that ability in all these different situations in our life, working with ourselves, we can also really help the people around us see this as a possibility, as a way to engage with life in a way that we can let go, recognize that just because we're filled with desire or anger or whatever, that doesn't mean that we have to follow it. And it doesn't mean that we have to be driven by our emotions. That we can, you know, become the master. get these wonderful results of being able to let go quicker and being able to find happiness behind the intensity that might be around us, and be able to see more, sense more, understand more about what's happening than we could when we were caught up in how we feel. I hope that makes sense. Any other questions or comments? Yes.
You had touched upon the like one of the difficulties of parenting after the divorce. One of the things you mentioned was that you don't have another person to support you. Is there anything, any other specific things that you found like challenging, especially as you know through the different phases of like you know toddler to teen?
Being divorced requires to, you know, there are so many different dynamics involved because first and foremost, to try to not say negative things about their other parent. Trying to point out the good in the other parent and if there's something toxic in that environment, to try to help your child see that in the most productive way possible. To not shove it under the rug, to be aware of what's happening and then try to work with it in a way that keeps them as safe as possible. So that's one thing. But hopefully your ex is pretty good with the kids and you don't have to worry too much about that. And then, you know, like what does it mean to like be this part-time parent perhaps? And to really always affirm how important they are in our life and how much we appreciate being in their life and how much we're willing to listen to them no matter what they have to say. I think that one of the main things that we can do as parents is give up, let go of the ideas of who we want them to become and help them become who they want to become. Try to really be able to listen, to ask them questions, to not in a leading, I'm leading you to do what I want you to do, but what is it you want for your life? What do you want from this situation you're experiencing at the age of 10 with your friend at school? You know, like just trying to do the best you can to open up whatever might be the taboo subjects. Maybe the taboo subjects that were part of your upbringing and be able to really be there for them for that. It's pretty wonderful when your child comes to you when they're in their teens and they tell you about something that's going on for them. Like maybe their first encounter with sex with their boyfriend or girlfriend, and they want to know what you think. And giving them unsolicited advice is not so helpful, but waiting for them to ask is good. And, you know, they may come to you and ask, you know, what do you think about mind trying this or doing that, it might be something you really think is awful. And then, you know, just like, well, here's the dangers that I can foresee. What is it that you want, hope to get out of this? You know, just, and trying to let go of the image we have about who they should be. And I think that trying to keep them from doing long-term damage to themselves is a really good guideline. Let everything else be the small stuff.
Yeah, and just like, I feel like even I can't see the answer, like kind of, so what is the approach, you know, what is the best approach if you're trying to prevent long-term damage, but you don't want to be overprotected?
Yeah, I mean, it depends on what age they are in a way, because they have more ability to set boundaries and hold them when they're younger,
mm-hmm.
but when they're older, when they're at a point where you know, you really, you can't control it. And hopefully when they're younger, you're trying to minimize the amount of force that you use at all junctures, whenever possible. So the more we force them, the less they're going to listen to us when they get older. And the more we can engage them in the problem solving of a situation, the more we can, you know, just share with them why it's important to us that certain things happen and get done or whatever, and then invite them to make the choice to help. The more we can do that instead of like just laying down the law,
mm-hmm.
the more we'll have the cred to be listened to later. Especially if we're willing to listen to why they don't want to do what we want them to do. And then, you know, point out that maybe their reason is valid, if it is valid, or, because sometimes we learn incredible things, like this one child who didn't want to go to school, and the mom was trying to just get her to go to school, maybe a little one, 5 years old, and then the mom just stopped and was really asking her, really engaging her in conversation about why she didn't want to go to school. And what came out of it was that she wanted more time with me. And this is like, I want to go to school because I want to spend time with you. And so the mom could make more time with her when she wasn't in school, and they could work out a way to do this, you know? And it's like, okay, this is a very nice happy ending. But, you know, for whatever, whenever we can, as we are raising them, to work through things and guide things in a really good moral way and demonstrate our own good morality to them and the reasons for it and the long-term benefits of what it's like to be a person that can be trusted in the world and be looked up to. You know, those kinds of things. And then, you know, as they get older, when they, instead of trying to lay down the law and, you know, like lock them up in the room, you know, the best thing to do is to really just continue with that kind of discussion about the consequences of actions. And I agree that if you're too strict, they just slip through your hand like sand and rebel. It's like people say that it's just absolutely like normal and required that teenagers rebel, and that is not my experience. We don't really have to, we don't necessarily have to give them something they have to rebel against. If we're a team, you know, we're a team in helping you succeed in your life. It's a different approach. And the Buddha, I'll just kind of close with this one last. The way the Buddha acted with the people in training under him, he always talked to them about what they were doing. He never took somebody else's report and then kind of like tell them off or whatever. Whenever somebody came to him and said, so-and-so is doing this, he would say, okay, ask so-and-so to come see me. And then he would say, so are you doing this? This is what I've been told. Are you doing this? The really incredible thing is nobody ever lied to the Buddha. I think that's probably because if you lie to the Buddha, your head splits into 9 pieces or something. So you don't do that. But parents don't always have that kind of spiritual sway. So, but you know, like always inquiring and not assuming that they're doing the wrong thing or that they're doing what you hear that they're doing. And the same when kids are fighting, you know, like, it's like really listening to them. And it's a respect. Treating each other with respect. So I thought it was really great that the Buddha, every story is like this. And he talks with them about what they were thinking, about what they're doing, what their intention is. And then if they're really like totally off track, he'll say, that is really stupid. Something like that. That's going to have bad, really bad results. So I think that's kind of it for tonight. Thank you for your attention. I hope that was valuable.